maybe because I was afraid and I wasn't ready for the consequences of my actions. But I remember last time they talked about that baptism that I had.
Yeah.
Well, for me, for some reason, that baptism kind of was a marker of not going back. And so when I got baptized, and actually you see this, especially in the Middle East and other countries, when a baptism is not just a physical act kind of representing what happens on the inside, it's a marker of you no longer now belong to anyone else. Like, this is now, you are with Christ, you have died with Christ, and you come alive in Him. And so it just was very symbolic and kind of a marker for me of whatever doubts I had, now I was letting go of. Like, this was it. And so I think part of it was that. Part of it was just the circumstances of everything leading to where it had. So that would be my answer.
Did your grandchild
live about
2 or about
6 to Florida? Is he like out of the region? Yeah. So it was a very scary time for him. I remember one story he told me. I think the cops had come and had literally ravaged his house. Like, everything was turned over. And some of them even believed him and said, if she doesn't show up within the next 24 hours, we will put you in jail. And so that was kind of when I decided, okay, I think I need to make a decision of you know, being honest with them so that other people in my life don't get harmed. So he's actually, thank the Lord, he is fine. He was never put in jail. There's a lot of heat and pressure around him during that time, but he's doing great now. He's actually a pastor at a church, an inner city church, and married, and his kids. And, yeah, it's really, really, really sweet. So Angela and I, oh my, she was such a profound individual. Just the courage that she had in approaching me and being bold just to invite me to come to church with her, and she didn't know who I was. And kind of course, and, you know, in middle school and high school, there's always a tension of wanting to be accepted and wanting to belong. And so for to do something like that was very bold, I would say. So we were really good friends a couple years into our friendship. We would write letters, we would, you know, just really close, but she actually ended up moving away about a year before I left my family. So we lost and we were not in contact for a while. So it was really, she was really confused because she knew what was happening, but I ran away from home and she didn't even know what I was doing or what was happening. She was out of the country. Probably years after I went away from home. So that was a really beautiful moment to come back together again and just cry together and look at what the Lord has done. And now we talk a lot more. So we try to FaceTime as much as we can. And, she has graduated college and now is in Wheaton studying to be a psychologist. So, counselor, I guess. So, yes, ma'am.
Oh, would you just repeat the questions when somebody asks you, because we can't hear them?
Oh, yes.
And also, I want to know, you didn't talk too much about Sharia law, just for how extensive is it, and is there any protection from our police or, you know, our laws for people that are, you know, in your situation?
It's a great question. Okay, so the question was, what is Sharia law? And is there any protection within our society that kind of helps people who may be bound by that law? Okay, so I'm going to try my best to give you a little mini Islamic lesson. And again, I shared this yesterday. I am trying really hard not to generalize. My experiences are my experience. So can't really take my situation and plaster it on every single individual who converts. But this is my experience. So we have, what is the supreme law of the land in our country? Constitution, right? statutes. Well, for a Muslim, there is there are set of Islamic laws, just like we have our constitution. No matter where you are, whether you're in the U.S., whether you're in Europe, whether you're in Spain, wherever you are, that is the law that you adhere to, even if that country does not adhere to that law. So even though my parents are in the United States, their first allegiance and their first accountability, what they answer to, is Sharia. So to put it really simply, Sharia is basically a code of law. Regulate where we eat, and the prayers you say before you get up, or, you know, go to the bathroom, go to sleep, just prayers in which you communicate to God. But then Sharia is a law that basically says if a man leaves his faith, then kill him. So, again, as I had mentioned last night, there's this concept of honor and shame. So, anytime honor is kind of lost, whether it be conversion, it could be even as simple as becoming more Western. Actually, a lot of the women that have been killed have been for much minor offenses, like having Western boyfriends or dressing in Western clothes. So my case was slightly extreme, I just outrightly converted completely. But the law can even account for much smaller offenses. Does that answer your question?
Sort of.
Okay. Sorry, I wish I had more. So I'm kind of in a catch because I'm not an expert on Islam. You know, I can't tell you, okay, in the Quran, on this section is this is what it states. But I'm more of the epistemological, actual experience of living that. So have you guys heard of Nabil Qureshi?
Mm-hmm.
Right? So he's more of the other side of, like, very intellectual, can break down exactly certain aspects. But I'm more of, I lived it. So, yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Last night you spoke about feeling the presence of the Lord. So my question is, have there been other times that you have experienced that? And
mm-hmm.
Can you share some of those?
Sure. Okay, so the question was, I talked about feeling the presence of the Lord, and lovely ladies asking if there are other times in my life that I felt the presence. Okay, so you know how when you first become a believer, I don't know what your stories are, but oftentimes in our journey, I've heard this phrase often, that you come to know the Lord and it's almost like a high, you know, where you're just so excited, the whole world is new, you've just been plucked out of darkness, especially for people who have come out of really dark, like drastic backgrounds, and then it gets really difficult. Because you're like, all of a sudden you don't feel God anymore, you know, and so you start, it's just this battle of learning how to be faithful in the midst of not feeling anything. But I would say, yeah, majority of my walk, it hasn't been this like wonderful, like high every single day where you just feel the Lord and you're just excited. You know, there are days where there's a lot of sorrow and a lot of, you know, questions, but I would say the presence of God is the Spirit, Emmanuel, God with us, living in me, you know? And have I felt His presence? Yes, absolutely. You know, moments in worship, but that doesn't always last, you know? Or when I'm praying with a friend, but I think those moments are actually markers to remind us of what we are looking for, which is heaven. You know, one day we'll be with Him, and that feeling will actually is a foretaste of living in eternity without sin, you know, no longer being bound in darkness, being free in Him. And so definitely I've had moments, but it's, I think often our Christian walk is one of faith. Yes?
How long were you in jail?
How long was I in jail?
They said you were adorable.
Just like they're looking at this whole room. How long was I in jail? I was in jail for a couple days. It was a very, very, very scary moment in my life. But I would say, actually, talking about the presence of God, that was one of the most strongest points in my life where I felt Him the most. Yes, ma'am.
Do all Muslims practice Sharia law?
That's a really hard question for me to answer. I haven't talked to every Muslim, but I think it's very common, or at least let's put it this way, it's expected that you do. So there are instances where a family may choose not to adhere to it because they're, you know, a bit more lax on the rules, but the expectation is that. Yes, sir.
Would you change your life anyway? Seeing other people who went to what's the next hard issue, would you like, if you had the chance to go back, change it, switch bodies or lives?
To make it easier, you
mean? Yeah, to make it easier.
Yeah. So the question is, would I change what happened? You know, all the hardships and looking at other people and whose lives have been slightly easier. You know, honestly, there were moments where I would have said yes to that question. But if I really am honest with myself, I have no doubt I wouldn't. Because you see, the Rifqa that you see right now, in all my brokenness and all my, you know, fears and strengths, it's because of those things that have happened. So actually, I think I would be a completely different person if those hardships had not come. I think it's made me who I am, and actually the best parts of me are because of those moments. I think of this picture when gold is made, it's placed in a furnace, and it refines it and it purifies it. And I think my testing, my trials have been similar, that all of the bad parts about me that are not, you know, that are being sanctified through my struggles have been and are continuing to be. So, great question. Yes, ma'am? Oh my goodness. What's my favorite color? Oh gosh. I used to be pink for a very, very long time, and then it was yellow. And I think now I'm in the whole coral phase. You know, like corally, like the beachy, you know, Florida color. Yeah, so it might change soon. You might find the lipstick color that color. I'm so excited. Yes, sir.
Are you still like in danger from your dad?
It's a great question. Okay, so see that guy over there? That's Jeremy. He's wonderful. You may wonder why he follows me. So that's actually part of it. So Jeremy, in these events, is here to protect me. Obviously, there's nothing wrong, like, really gonna hurt me. But it's kind of a precautionary method because of everything that's happened. So is my life in danger? To be quite honest, that is a question that I ask myself recently a lot. Because I think many people have different opinions, and I don't even know the answer to that. I just know that there is a threat. I don't know how big it is. So at this point in my life, it's more precautionary. So, you know, Jeremy is here. I hope that's okay that I said his name. Okay, right, okay. But if not, like people don't know where I live. People don't know where I work, at least outside of where I work, or go to school. So in the public, it's very secretive. So yeah, those are questions I'm still asking myself as I proceed to getting the career, you know, going to law school, all of those things, how that can change. Yes.
You say you didn't really go into detail on how you told your dad and like how they reacted to it?
Yeah, okay, so the question was how I told my dad and how I reacted to it. I think on that question, it might be easier for you to read that part in the book. I asked that for two reasons. One, it's really hard to talk about. But two, I think it'll give you some context to how it actually happened. Because there are a few factors that play into that momentous time that would take longer to answer. Yes?
How would you describe your life post-converting? And, you know, because you've asked so many questions about your past, I want to know, like, what is it now? You're a best-selling author. Like, what's your life now?
That's an awesome question. So her question is, we've talked a lot about my past. What is my life like currently? you probably are looking at my life, you know, from the audience thinking, wow, this is exciting. You know, you have a New York Times bestselling author, you talk on shows often. But to be honest, my life is very normal. It's just like yours. I have dishes to do, I have friends, you know, I go to school, so I'm finishing up school. I'm studying for this big exam called the LSAT to get into law school. I'm working for an internship that I can't talk
talk about where I have amazing friends and community. I go to church that is involved with inner city ministry, and that place is home, very much home. So one of the best parts of my life, I think, is, you know, I think for the longest time I struggled with these two versions of who I am. You know, on one side, here I'm sharing, but you don't know me. Like there's not, you know, there's a gap. But being able to go back home, and people have seen me on bad days. People have wept with me. You know, those individuals have walked with me for years. And so that's really, I think, beautiful for me to have people in my life that I know love me for who I am and all of my brokenness and all of my strengths. We're committed to walking with each other through whatever comes. So, yes.
Do you have friends?
Yeah, they do. They do. The close ones do. There are people that I think don't know, but my very dear friends know even parts of the story that I don't share with people. Yes, ma'am.
If you could give advice of how you stay close to the Lord, through the trials, through the everything, what would you say are some of the pearls that the Lord has offered you in your own prayer life, or your own, you know, how do you stay close to Jesus?
That is a great question. So the question is, so how have I stayed close to the Lord through my trials and through the hardships I've faced? I would say, I would comfort everyone who is listening to that question with the verse that talks about how God is faithful to keep us even when we stumble. And the reality is God is more committed to you and your growth in him than you are, than anyone else is. Like he has purchased you with his own blood. Like how committed is he? And so I think the hardest part in trials is it can feel like very much like as if God has forsaken you and you're led by just emotions. And so the things that have stabilized me in my suffering, I'd probably say are a few things. In my hardest of times, this sounds very, may sound counterintuitive, but it's fasting. Fasting has been a weapon for me in those days where I don't know what's truth and what's lie. Where I'm confused, where I feel overwhelmed by darkness, where I know this is a very spiritual battle I'm facing and I don't know what to do, so I fast. That has been actually, for me, fasting has been a lifestyle, so it doesn't have to be big. I mean, it could be a meal. It could be something little, whatever. It could be coffee. It could be whatever, but using that time to turn to the Lord, very similar to the story in Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You know, how did they withstand the pressure to fit into the culture of Babylon? They fasted and they resisted, and I think it's a very spiritual thing because you in and of yourself cannot resist the evil one. You need him. And so in those moments where I'm very apathetic or just going my own way, it's kind of brought me back to the Lord. So fasting, I think having being very, very cautious of what I listen to, of what I let into my eyes and in my heart. So the things I'm meditating on, you know, and I think music for me personally is a very big thing. I'm a singer, I play the guitar, so music moves me to the core of who I am. And so, being wise about the kind of music I listen to, because I find it often, I meditate on it. So it's not just this, like, you're listening to it, there's something powerful about it. So choosing that wisely and the things you watch. And I know, I hope I'm not trying to come across as like there here are these perfect formulaic things that you can do. It's really being led by the Lord. You know, what's hard for me may not be hard for you. What's hard for you may not be hard for me. And so, and I think that's really communicating with Jesus and asking him, God, show me how to love you, how to be faithful, how to be a steward. But I think those are kind of for me have been ways. And then the last thing would be good community. Find people who you want to be like. Find people who are stronger in you, stronger in the Lord than you are, who inspire you and encourage you. And there are those people out there. So asking God to give you wise friends, that's been huge. So I have quite a few friends who are not afraid to call me out on sin and challenge me and inspire me. And it's all in the little faithful things. Yes.
You talked a little bit last night about wanting to end your life a few times, and what I know, like, there's always different circumstances, and like people go through different things, different reasons why they would want to do that. But what is some advice that you would give, like, in retrospect, to somebody who has friends that are maybe going through that same thing? Like, some advice for that.
Awesome. So this is a question on. I talked about wanting to end my life yesterday when I was younger. So her question was, how do you advise people, or, I don't know, pertaining to that issue, any thoughts on that? I would say, if you have a friend struggling with it, really looking at it as, I think compassion is key. Understanding that this is an individual who is hurting and broken, and the tendency is to isolate and to kind of go inverted and to not seek help. And so if it's you that's struggling with it, I would say immediate response is talk to people, go to somebody. You know, there's power in bringing something to the light. If it's a friend that you're struggling with, I would say pray for them. And if they're willing, because most likely if they are struggling with it, they wouldn't want you to tell someone. So encourage them to seek something, because I would think that in a situation like that, they're really hungry for just compassion and love. So they might actually be very open to talking to someone. They just might need some encouragement in doing so. Yes?
Have you ever, like, returned to your family? Mm-hmm. And if so, what did you learn from your family?
Wow. So very, very insightful questions. My goodness. Wow. Very impressed. So the question was, have I ever resented my family, and how did I learn to deal with that? Okay. You are hitting on to a very key point with my story. I think the best way I can describe it is resentment and bitterness is like a poison. You're, by feeding yourself with resentment and bitterness, you're essentially killing yourself. And I think the antidote to that is prayer. And yes, I have very much struggled, more so not with resentment, but with anger, just with the injustice of it all, and just angry that it shouldn't have been that way, and maybe resentment alongside that. But I think one thing that God has really, it has been the Lord gifted me with, is I think the prayer, you know, where I started praying for my family the minute I got saved. I was 13, and I would just cry and cry and just pray. And as I got older, it became more difficult to pray for them. But I think that actually has helped me where now it's almost as if I see them for who they should be in a word, you know? And I think it's really hard to explain, but it's kind of like when you don't see someone for a very long time, you start, at least for me, you start forgetting the faults. And so for me, I think it's more, I miss them so much and I hurt for them so much, and the Lord has truly, I think, given me compassion for them that I think prayer has really helped push back resentment. Now, that's not to say there's not anger or, like, you know, intense, just like, Lord, why? But I think a lot of that has been wrestled through the first couple of years after the teaching. And now I'm at a place where things are just different for me internally. Yes, ma'am.
I just wondered, do you have a favorite song, or would you sing it for us? And feel free to sing now.
Oh, my goodness. You know what's funny? I have gotten this question more than once. Okay.
There's a guitar behind you.
Oh, my goodness. Okay. Maybe not the guitar. I would love to worship with you. Yes, but on one condition. You all have to sing with me.
Okay.
Will you do it?
Yeah.
Will you sing with me? Okay. Let's pick one. Do you guys know the song? It's one of my favorites. Oh man, I've so many. I'm like, this is so hard. I have one. You guys know the song Bless the Lord by Matt Redman? Okay. Actually, can you pull up my lyrics for it just to make sure I have it and then we can sing it? And I'll lead us and we can sing. Also, you guys want to know something really funny? Yesterday, I forgot my passcode for like 4 hours. I'm serious. Like, that's how I'm like, wow, really? I know it now. But.
Evangelism, it's almost like someone else's project. Like,
let me fix you, or let me bring you something that would change your life. And really, I think it's easy for, this is for me speaking, it's easy for me to see it as me being the savior, but I would challenge you to become their friend, get to know them. You know, what are they like? Who are they? What are their dreams? What are their fears? It's really helpful. It's, well, very much, I think, in that question, I would seek the Lord in knowing how to do that. But I think for Muslims in particular, what moved me wasn't necessarily, you know, anything about Angela that was different besides her willingness to go with me into the dirt and to weep with me and get to know me as a friend. And that was powerful, the power of love, I think. And so that kind of drew me into being like, why are you different? Like, why do you care? Like, why, what makes you so unique? And then seeing that Jesus was behind that answer. Yes?
How exactly did
I damage my eye? Yes, so this eye is actually not a real eye. It's a prosthetic eye, so it covers the damaged eye. So when I move my eye, sometimes it doesn't work at the same time. But so I was 6 years old, I think, and I was playing with a toy airplane, and I was playing with my brother, and we were just like tossing it around, and he refused to give it to me. It was a toy airplane. And so I said something like, I'm gonna tell mom, and so he was just like, whatever. And so he threw it my way and it went in my eye.
Cool.
Yeah. So it was definitely not intentional. But oddly enough, you know, of course I didn't have this prosthetic eye for actually most of my life. It was only a couple years ago that I got it. So if you saw me, you would see a very damaged eye and a good eye. And so of course, like any person, it affected my ability to, I think, see myself in the way that God sees myself and insecurities. But you know what? I can honestly say that I am thankful for it. Because I look back, even in my high school years, and I think if I looked, had a beauty that was perceived as normal, I would have hung out with the wrong crowds. And then if I hung out with the wrong crowds, why would I need Jesus? Because in a moment I'm having fun, right? But it was in my loneliness, it was in my lack of fulfillment that I sought the Lord. And even now, I can relate to people. You see, now I am so drawn to the person in the room who no one talks to, and like the person who's handicapped, or anyone, whoever is the weak one in the room, I'm just like, that's where my heart is. Those are the people I want to be around. Because I know what it's like to be rejected. I know what it's like to be neglected for something that was completely out of your control. And so I'm so thankful for that, because actually I'm applying to law schools, and I'm writing a paper on how suffering is our greatest strength, and how often in society, I'm talking about the handicapped, they have a strength that is unseen. And I look at our suffering and our weaknesses, and I actually think God has in some ways given us a strength that is so hidden that it's like a weapon. That it sharpens us, but it can also destroy us, just like fire can destroy, but it can also refine. And so, yeah, although this awful thing happened, it's made me stronger, and I'm thankful for it. Or maybe one or two more questions, and then we'll go on to singing. Yes, ma'am.
Yesterday, I was here, and while you were telling your story, I remember you saying how you were thinking about your family before you left. And forgive me if I'm wrong, but I think you said that you had a baby brother that you used to take care of. Does he know what happened?
Thank you for asking. So if you turn to the first page of my book, actually it's dedicated towards him. It's a really hard topic to talk about. But my little brother's 11 years younger than me. And so yes, I actually played a role in caring for him. So he was 11. I was 11 when he first came home from the hospital. So you can only imagine being that age, and just, he was the joy of my life in the darkness that I went through. I don't really know what he knows about what happened, but it's definitely a piece of my life that I grieve a lot, and I pray for him so much. So yeah, it's really hard to say, but I have no contact with him. All right, one more question. Yeah, you're standing. You're like, no. Yes, sir.
I just want to know, like, what you do in your free time, or like, what activities you enjoy, or like, your sports.
Yeah. Oh my. Do I play sports? No. I can't even think of a bowling ball. Definitely not sports. But actually, I love to swing dance. So I know I'm on a ballroom team. So I have professional. It's not professional. It's like I have a professional instructor. So we've done salsa, we've done waltz, no longer on the team because I'm tired and I have so many other things, but I actually still dance. I love to swing dance, and it's cool because I'm really small, so we can do flips and stuff like that. This is awesome. Get my energy up there. What else do I do? Yeah, I would say probably the same thing. Oh, and I eat curry. I love curry. You need to know that. Oh my. All right, well, it is 6:56. Why don't we start? I'll pray for it. Actually, okay, one more question. I think. Oh, okay, both of you. I can't help saying no. I'm actually selling them. She can come see me and I'll sign a copy for you. Yes, ma'am. Older brother is still with my family, so I really don't know. So I'm praying for them a lot.
Do you have a family that looks that?
Oh yeah,
that you have now.
Oh yeah, so many, okay. so many. Good. Yes, very much so. I've got one in every state. Just kidding. But I do. I am bombarded with love and people who have known me and walked with me for a long time. Mm-hmm. So, can I pray for us and then we can go ahead and sing together? Jesus, I thank you that you are with us. Thank you that you have called us out of our own darkness and you continually pour your life and truth. And Father, I just pray that you would take my words and all of its weaknesses. You would use it to your glory, God. That you would just allow our hearts to hunger for you. And I pray that we would not live for this world and its fleeting pleasures, but that we would take all the gifts you've given that are good, that we can glorify you with it. And I pray that you would create in us a grounding and a longing for heaven, and that we would stand for what is right, that we would stand for truth and have courage and point others to you, Lord. I just pray for every single heart in here, Lord, for those who are hurting, those who long to feel you and to be changed by you. I pray that you would meet them and that you would show them just how close you are. Father, I ask that you would create in us a heart that truly worships you and loves you with everything, more than life. And I pray that you would make us fully, wholly yours. In Jesus' name.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. Sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing the song again. Whatever makes us and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name.
John and some of the other folks. So we'd love to see you there, and then right after we'll be
Actually, we've got about 10 minutes, and we'll be back here at 2:55.
Correct.